databases. Scary stuff. No, I'm kidding. Just kidding. There's nothing scary about databases. And in fact, that's exactly what this series is about. We're going to demystify your database. Good morning, Database Universe Hitchhikers, broadcasting from the 31st parallel, bringing to you the topic of being a good SQL Server Scientist. What exactly is involved in building this mystical creature, and how can you become one of these unicorns? First of all, I want to remind you that in our previous conversation, we talked about advantages of the scientific method and how it can be applied cost-effectively to our business practices, especially with regards to SQL Server, of course. Now, one thing that I intentionally didn't stress enough in a previous conversation, because I wanted to save it for this one, is the power of observation and what exactly does it mean for existentially for being a scientist. And it's very important. I don't want, it may sound trivial, like, you know, power of observation, okay, I can see what's going on. But really, it's a lot more to that. In fact, many people credit Darwin's success exactly to that, that he was excellent in observation, that his advantage over other peers that were trying to, racing to say the same theory, was in his unparalleled power of observation, his ability to categorize and to find the right drawer, as it were, for everything. And that is exactly the quality that we need to develop in ourselves if we really want to be good SQL Server scientists. And to that, we need to be aware of a very interesting thing called observation bias. I like to use this keyhole a lot of times because it really stresses the point that our best tool, our mind, is also our worst enemy. How is it that our best friend becomes our worst enemy? Because the very ability that allows us to theorize and to detect patterns and to advance ourselves in a logical way is also the tool for the downfall of many, because we do it preconditionally, and then our ideas already color the facts, so we kind of don't see the things for what they really are. Because there's just the way that the human mind works, that no matter what, the stream of data that is hitting your sensors, be it your eyes, be it your ears, be it your skin, it's too much. No one can process all the information coming in at once. So we are forced to have some sort of a filter. Keyhole syndrome is not a syndrome, really. That's the way of life. There's no one out there is processing all the information at once. They're processing some sort of a filtered set. And we need to be aware of that, because in order to be good scientists and to achieve real excellence in the field of SQL Server performance, we need to be able to control this filter. Not that the filter control us, but we control it, so that we can point it to the right direction, so the observations become more valuable. You can compare that a little bit to the medical field. You know, you go to a doctor and you say, "I have a cough," and he says, "Oh, great, so come into the MRI room, we're going to check your brain, and then afterwards we're going to check your fungi on your feet." What? Get me out of here. What am I doing here? You need to point your observation to the right area. You need to have the fundamental knowledge, the understanding of what it is that goes into the human body, that functioning of a human body, what it is that makes the SQL Server tick. If you don't know what the I/O subsystem does, if you don't know how CPU is managed, if you don't know what the memory and cache management is, get out of the kitchen. You have no business being a data center. First, you have to learn about these pieces, in order to be able to observe what's going on. The best, the latest performance, the monitoring system is not going to help you. It's just going to be dots and lines without any meaning. Unless you understand exactly what does the SQL Server, the query engine do? How does the query plan function? And you have a query that takes too long and is processing tons of loads. It's got millions of reads. And you're going and you're checking your CPU utilization. You got nothing to do in the data center. Go back to school. You have to understand what to observe in order for the observation to be effective. You can't just go by trial and error. And the observation, dispassionate observation, mind you, has to be guided by fundamental knowledge. And we, of course, will, in the further conversations, and talk more about it. But you have to understand that, first of all, in order to build a house, you have to have a foundation. And deeper the foundation, the stronger walls you can build. Because you can't build a skyscraper on a 5 feet foundation. You have to dig deep in order to build tall. And if you want the real fast troubleshooting, really pinpointed understanding, you need to have a deep foundation. And it goes further, not only by the fact that you understand what are your possibilities, not only will you be able to pinpoint your observation to the correct area to troubleshoot an existing problem, but also by the same token, you will be able to avoid these problems in the future, because you will build this system from the get-go with an understanding that if I do this, this will increase the possibility of failure in such and such area, and therefore you will take steps to avoid it. So this way you can have peace and quiet, and you don't have to worry about your phone going off in the middle of the night, and your CIO will be happy, and you will have something really valuable that you've contributed to the organization. And that's what the real true value is of fundamental knowledge coupled with dispassionate analysis.